What's up everybody, Tom here with another video. Today we'll be talking about the latest stock market news, along with our technical analysis thoughts on the S&P 500, Nasdaq, Apple, Tesla, and the volatility index. We've seen some pretty big volatility in the stock markets over the month of September. And while this is very normal, we're seeing a structure formation currently on the S&P 500 and Nasdaq that could lead to another big move downwards if it was to break. So what's sentiment telling us in the markets and what are we seeing? Stay tuned. All right, as we always like to do, let's take a look at the general stock market to get a bit of an idea on what's currently going on. I do believe we're seeing a decent amount of sector rotation in the markets right now, as of course the Federal Reserve came out this week with Jerome Powell hinting to a whole bunch of different things that has the market a little bit unnerved about, of course, big tech moving forward. So when we talk about these sector rotations, really what that's saying is that the market is now going and looking at value stocks, and potentially some of these value stocks are being bought up. Also, stocks to do with economic recovery are being bought quite closely, and that comes down to copper price, which we'll be looking at a little bit later in this video. Let's talk about the fear and greed index. Now, this one here is actually quite a good free index that you can get, and it shows you a whole bunch of things to do with fear and greed in the markets. Now, in the live stream last night, we were talking about this, and I wanted to bring in just a couple of things that if you're not aware, you should be looking at in the markets. One of those is, of course, the VIX and the volatility index. But on top of that, you should always be looking at things like put call options and put call ratios. Here we've got a bit of a chart of the last year of what's happened with put call ratios. Now, traditionally, when people don't expect something to happen in a market, it often does. And that was certainly the case this time around. We had, of course, extreme euphoria in the markets, an extreme high on the Nasdaq, and of course, new highs on the S&P. And at the same time, you'll notice that this put call ratio, as in the amount of puts in the market, was becoming the lowest it has been in 12 months. Now, after that point, we've of course seen a sharp fall in the markets and an increase, therefore, in the amount of puts that are coming into the markets. And I think there's a bit of a variation here that we need to be very careful of. Every time the put call ratio has got between about that 0.8 and that 1, we've seen usually the markets recover. Now, are we at that point right now? Not quite. But I would be looking at this and thinking if we're bottoming out or we're finding a level that's good support on the markets and we have the put call ratio going up to between a 0.8 and a 1, it could be one of those signs that we use in the markets to help you decide whether there's a bottom or, of course, it's safe. Another thing is this fear and greed index over time. Whenever it goes over, of course, this area here between the 70 and the 80, we're usually approaching a bit of euphoria in the market. And whether we had a crisis this year or not, we were already in extreme euphoria. So there would have been a correction sometime through Feb, March, I think anyway, even if we weren't in a crisis. Volume's been up in the last couple of days. The revised volumes here are showing quite a lot of trading activity around those economic events. And also, just to bring up sentiment and economic activity, I think things like Snowflake are definitely worth bringing up. Now, Snowflake is a company that, of course, Warren Buffett's company invested in as well. It's an IPO, and it went up 100% in its first day. Now, is this unusual in the US market for tech? It's certainly not. But on this channel, I have a bit of a rule that I say a lot in the live streams, and that is that you should see a few years generally of a company on the stock market before you consider buying it. That allows all the financials to come out, and it allows, of course, as much as possible for the stock to be covered and to realize some kind of profit. Usually companies like Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, any other tech company, they've come out of the gates very strong, found lackluster results, and over the next 12 to 18 months, they've drifted lower, becoming better value at those points in time. We're even seeing it right now in Slack. If you have a look at Slack on the charts, it's not performing as well as you'd expect it to be right now in the markets. Let's have a look at the volatility index. Volatility has dropped a little bit because we're not seeing as sharper moves. We're sitting right on support now in the stock markets around the world. And volatility in terms of the VIX is doing its normal thing where the initial spike happened off, of course, that flash crash. Then we saw a pullback in the VIX and we'll probably see a little bit of juddering and sputtering similar to last time over here on the left. Now, the VIX is one of those things that's difficult to trade because of the cost, but at the same time, we use it more as a gauge where it's above the 20. anything can happen, and we can see some extreme volatility. When it's below the 20, we're in usually a very normal market. On to the dollar index, what's happening here? Well, the 92 is of course firms, and after the Fed news, we really are seeing it still trading within this range. If we go down to a daily time frame, you'll notice here that while it had some initial strength, it's still really stuck in between the range between the 93.80 and the 92. And we've effectively got dollar not knowing what it wants to do, whether it wants to find strength or it wants to find weakness. I think that TA wise, it's very difficult for us to find a real trade here right now, but we'd always be wanting to set alerts for either of those sides. And of course, down here, there could be buying opportunities, and up here, there could be selling opportunities as well because of the nature of a channel pattern formation. On to copper. Now, copper is looking incredibly bullish. We're about right now, not only to make a new high, which we've done, but to break and close to a new high. Now, we're big believers on this channel about copper, and the essence of copper going up usually is very positive for the markets. So we saw materials do quite well yesterday, and of course we've seen a general strength in the S&P compared to the Nasdaq, which has been usually the better performer. And this is because the economic recovery is supposedly underway. We're seeing decent figures coming out, although that can be argued either way, but copper is certainly performing well. And this was of course a channel pattern formation that we've been talking about. So if it breaks out, we expect quite a lot of strength in copper, and in fact that be quite positive for the markets. I'd still want another daily close above, and then of course the conservative entry style that we always talk about. But at this point, copper is looking positive, showing that this pullback in the market is most likely just a corrective phase. Tesla here continues to be incredibly strong compared to the rest of the market. It bounced very heavily off the pre-structure. So we were talking about this structure over here acting as support. It certainly did, and then it moved up. And right now, Tesla is all about battery day. That will be next week, and we should be hopefully talking about that in a live stream as well. If we go down to a 4 hour, in terms of what we're seeing, there is some structure around this 420 with previous resistance acting as support and a 20. And then there's also buying support here at around this 388 to 390 zone, where previous resistance, previous support, and previous resistance could act as a zone of buying pressure. Now, Tesla's one of those ones that I expect to hold up into the battery day. And what we've seen recently is a lot of buy the rumor, sell the news kind of events. So will Tesla live up to the hype? It's a good sentiment tracker in the markets right now. Speaking of sentiment, here we've got Apple. Now, Apple came out with a news event that was certainly not to the market's expectations. Last night, we saw an open, or at least a futures open, in the 108 area. And Apple, if it had broken down and closed below there, I think instantly exposed really the $100 price range. It exposed all the way, filling through to the gap to the $100 area. We saw it hold 110. And close right around that 50 EMA. But again, if Friday is weak and we see further selling pressure, as soon as it gets through this structure, really what that's saying is it moves to the next zone. And the next zone certainly around that $100. Some people have been saying 97 as well, but between that $100 and 97 range is certainly very, very key when it comes to Apple. If we have a look at the weekly as well, it becomes even more apparent why this is going to be good support. 20 moving average on the weekly sitting right around that level. And again, I think that Apple will only break low if we see a big break of the Nasdaq, which we'll be talking about in just a minute. On to the S&P 500. Now, of course, we've been talking about this. Monthly pivots do matter on the S&P 500. We're still sitting around that monthly S1. But if we get down to the monthly S2 and we break through the current range, we're going to be going to 3200 flat. And we've talked about how that is a very key zone in terms of structure and in terms of the market overall. If we have a look at what's going on right now and we actually consider, yes, the market is pretty much being trapped between these two moving averages, the 20 exponential moving average and the 50 exponential moving average, we go down to something like a 4 hour, we're effectively trapping the market within a range. Now, what do we know about ranges? When ranges are broken, they have good targets. They also show a coiling of the market. Effectively, the market is stuck within an area, and when that area breaks, it has a high statistical chance of going to the next area or zone. Now, what does this area break if it gets below this point to? Well, it instantly points to a channel bottom, which goes to the 3200. It goes to the S2 pivot. It goes to previous weekly resistance. There's a lot of synergies in terms of technical analysis with the S&P 500 in that level. we're obviously below a whole bunch of moving averages. We've got the 20-50 crossover here. If the market continues to fall down, this 20 will meet with the 50 as well and potentially cross down. We may stay in the channel for a little while before breaking low or something like that. But in terms of the bulls that want the market to go up right now, you need it to buy off this zone. Usually I have a bit of a rule with channels, the first touch, the second touch, and the third touch, all of these touches are usually respected. Now, if the market does not bounce off this zone and it comes down for the fourth touch, often the fourth touch is actually a very weak point in the market. The fourth touch does not often hold the market. And why that is? Well, it's purely down to statistics. I guess if it tests the level enough times, it's really showing weakness. Another thing with TA is that if you have, let's say, the first touch and it bounces all the way to the high, the second touch and it bounces all the way to the high, the third touch and it goes like halfway and then comes back down to touch again, what's that telling us about the psychology in the market? Well, it's saying it was strong here, as in there was buying pressure. It was strong here as it was buying pressure, as it pushed all the way up. And then this third time, it weakened. The buying, the dip pressure was not as strong. We saw it only get halfway up and then come back down. Another reason why often the fourth touch does not work as well. Onto the Nasdaq, probably my favorite chart at the moment in terms of figuring out sentiment in the markets. Well, the Nasdaq is certainly showing very heavy support around this 10,950 to 11,000 on the futures. Futures trading has been relatively negative in the Asian session yesterday, and usually before that, positive each day. We've found support again at, of course, this 10,950 zone on the futures, and we've bounced off that. Now, again, it comes down to the 1, 2, 3. We've got 1, 2, 3. Do we find the market going up and testing the highs again? Of course, that would be a bullish indicator inside of the channel. A break high would be incredibly bullish, and we've talked about that quite a lot in some of our videos. But if we go up maybe to the 20 moving average over here on the 4 hour and then start to push back down and touch the fourth time, this is really putting a lot of downward pressure on the markets. And that's when we're setting up for a pretty large move to the downside. What distance do we get? Like any good channel, we take the distance of the move from, of course, the low to the high. We extrapolate that out and hope there's some market structure behind that point. And the great thing about this particular channel, if this was to happen, there is certainly market structure. Now, how do you trade these type of things? I always get asked that question in the live stream. The best way to trade it is to wait for confirmation. Just like we saw over here before the Fed announcement, we didn't get confirmation. If the market closes through this low down here, as in the body candles close below, that is bearish. That could be maybe your trigger. That's obviously the breakout signal. There is another way of looking at it though, where you wait for it to come back and test the previous supports, and that becomes resistance, known as roll reversal in technical analysis. At that point, then you look at going, of course, short, and you make your own decisions. But at the end of the day, that's the kind of conservative answer that you can go with TA. So that probably wraps up our thoughts on the NASDAQ and the S&P 500 right now. We've got options expiry as well in the US, which is always an important time for Wall Street to push the market to whatever, of course, is the strike that is less picked. At this point, we're really thinking, can the weekend cause selling in the afternoon? Remember, if we see selling in the afternoon coming into a weekend, that is usually the big people taking out their trades, closing them because they're concerned about event risk or some kind of risk on the weekends. It doesn't show good sentiment for the markets as well. So again, it all comes down to the end of the day rather than the start of the day in the stock market. If you've enjoyed this video, please make sure to, of course, subscribe and hit that alert button. And we're doing a live stream next Monday at the bell as well. So I really appreciate everyone's support, and I wish you all the best in your markets, whether you're investing, trading, or doing whatever else you're doing. Bye for now.